días a todos. Vamos a empezar un poco con retraso esta sesión. Yo tan solo como una breve introducción de esta sesión de Long Under Extreme Conditions is just to remind that ARDS is still a disease associated with a very high mortality and morbidity. Just to remember that still today the mortality is close to 30%. And unfortunately, the criteria for definition are still based on clinical and physiological criteria. And this is the Berlin definition is still a weak definition. So the problem that we don't have today a precise definition of ARDS because they didn't include any biological information of the lung, of the acute lung inflammation. And also we don't have, unfortunately, an specific treatment of ARDS. It's just to remember that ARDS is an non-homogeneous disease, and this is a very important concept. And normally, in addition to the cause of ARDS, there is a second heat produced by the mechanical ventilation and other complications or adverse events like pulmonary infections or the positive balance fluid, etc., that will influence enormously on the these patients. Just to remember that to prevent the damage induced by the mechanical ventilation is important lung of size and the degree of the inhomogeneity of the lung. And this can be detected by different different are included in the mechanical pore. That means that one the recommendation to keep the lung as possible to the homogeneous distribution of the ventilation and to try to prevent the volutrauma, because volutrauma is more important than the atelectrauma in these patients. And just to start with this session one, where we will cover different topics on the extreme conditions. The first talk will be by José Ángel Lorente from Getafe, Madrid. He will present the extreme inhaled injury and what should be done and what should be known. And then will be followed by the Gaston Murias from Buenos Aires, Argentina, that he will present data on fighting with ventilator and the asynchrony, the relevance of asynchronies in the lung. And finally, Dr. Pacheco Fortuna from Portugal, he will also talk about the new mode of mechanical ventilation. At the end of these three presentations, will be, if it's possible, we will have time for some questions and discussion. So I'm very pleased to introduce the first presentation by José Ángel Lorente, that I'm just looking at you in my computer. And José Ángel will present the topic on extreme inhaled injury. What do we have to know and do? José Ángel, tienes 15 minutos.
Thank you very much, Professor Artigas. I want to thank the organizers of the meeting for the invitation to talk about inhalation injury over the next 15 minutes. I'd like to say things that are interesting for every general intensivist, not specifically for those that have expertise in the management of inhalation injury and burn patients in general. I work in Hospital Universitario de Getafe in Madrid and in the National Network for Research in Respiratory Medicine, which is called CIBERES, and the European University in Madrid. So burn injury really evokes in the host, in the victim of burns, profound physiological changes in the cardiovascular and the respiratory system. We proved years ago that there are profound changes in the hemodynamics in these patients. The cardiac index is very low at the beginning, from the time of admission to 48 hours later. And this really reproduces what is known, or what was known already, the EP and the flow phase. The EP phase characterized by low cardiac index, hypodynamic response, and then as resuscitation evolves, the patient develops a high cardiac index and a hyperdynamic response. And this was accompanied also by changes in the gut perfusion. At that time, by gastric tonometry, we were able to measure the intramucosal PCO2 and proved that there was intramucosal gastric acidosis, indicating that the gut was really hypoperfused, at least during the first hours after injury. And these changes were more marked in patients who subsequently died as compared to patients who survived. You see a lower cardiac index in patients that, that are non-survivors as compared to survivors. So, and the relationship with oxygen delivery with mortality has been shown by other studies, like in this study by Holm in 2000, in which she showed that mortality was 100% of patients who had oxygen delivery less than 600, as opposed to a very low mortality rate for patients with oxygen delivery higher than 1,000 milliliters per minute per square meter. So inhalation injury, which is the topic today, is related to organ dysfunction. And several studies, like this one from 2003, studying a large number of burn patients, showed that several factors, like full thickness burn size, age, and inhalation injury, were associated with the development of multi-organ dysfunction after burns. They developed a scoring system for the quantification of organ dysfunction, similar to the SOFA score. And by using this, they, in this study, proved that patients with a higher score, with a higher degree of organ dysfunction, had more often inhalation injury, 34% of these patients, as compared to patients with lower degree of organ dysfunction, for whom only 12% had inhalation injury. So the concept that inhalation injury is led to organ dysfunction, patients with inhalation have more often organ dysfunction, is really in the literature already. And in this study, in a multivariate analysis, they proved that, or they found that inhalation injury was, with an odds ratio of 2.6, related to the development of organ dysfunction. We also showed in another study a very interesting finding, which really supports the old concept that these patients, after burned, have first the resuscitation phase, characterized by hemodynamic instability, followed by a phase of stability during the first week, from day 2 to day 7, which is called the calm before the storm. And then the storm, which comes after the first week. Surgery starts, sequential surgical interventions, higher risk of sepsis and organ dysfunction. And we really supported this concept that was in the literature from before by showing that the SOFA score increased both in survivors and non-survivors during the resuscitation phase from day 0 to day 4. So all patients get worse, but non-survivors get even worse than as compared to survivors. During the second part of the first week, there was the calm before the storm. Organ dysfunction really didn't change in non-survivors, although it improved a negative delta SOFA score in patients who later survived. So this gives us the opportunity to really try to prevent this worsening of organ failure in patients who non-survive, because this happens already after day 4. So the patients are already in the ICU, and we may be able to interfere with this worsening after the resuscitation phase, trying to improve their survival rate. This is the typical appearance of the patient who comes with inhalation injury, facial burns, burns in the eyelashes, in the eyebrows, in the nostrils, and really a situation in which if we were to intubate this patient at this point, intubation would be probably impossible. That's why we have to intubate these patients before they develop this situation, this edema, which is due to the burn, but also due to the resuscitation. So right after burn, this is not so marked, and we might be able to intubate this patient, but not after they develop this degree of edema. So intubation has to be really early when we suspect inhalation injury, and this is how these patients look after a few hours after the burn. And if you do a bronchoscopy in the severe cases, you see the carbonaceous material, the soot, which corresponds to the inhaled air at very high temperature, and the inflammatory response that evokes in the lower airway. And this really is associated with many complications that I will say later. And this is really the key slide of the presentation. We have to understand that when we talk about inhalation injury is not only a single syndrome. It is really three different syndromes with three different mechanisms and three different treatments and three different impact on mortality. First, we have the thermal injury to the upper airway. The upper airway is a very effective temperature exchanger. So the temperature might be at 300 degrees in the atmosphere in the burn, and then due to the function of the oropharynx, when air gets to the lower airway, temperature is only 50. So the thermal injury is limited to the upper airway. When we say this patient has a burn in the lower airway, this is not correct, because in this case it's an inflammatory response. The thermal injury is only limited to the upper airway. So in the oropharynx, the mechanism is thermal injury, and what we see is obstruction of the upper airway. This syndrome by itself has very low impact on mortality. Treatment is intubation. When edema decreases, we extubate the patient, usually after a few days, 4, 5, or 7 days, and there's no really impact on mortality. Then we have the involvement of the lower airway, and this is not thermal injury. This is due to the inflammatory response induced by the chemicals present in the atmosphere. And this causes purulent tracheobronchitis or neutrophilic tracheobronchitis, and this is associated with different findings. There may be X-ray abnormalities, atelectasis, gas exchange abnormalities due to VQ mismatch. And here, really, treatment is supportive, bronchial toilet, and the little else. And finally, we have what people think that this is common, but this is really uncommon, which is the typical picture of ARDS. And this only happens when the particles in the atmosphere are very small in size, they are able to reach the lower airway and the alveoli, and they induce an inflammatory response in the alveoli. And the permeability of the alveolocapillary membrane increases, and we have typical ARDS, typical non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema. So three different syndromes with very different impact on mortality. And finally, we have the effects of inhalation of carbon monoxide or cyanide, which are due to tissue hypoxia. And this is a completely different situation in which the lung can be involved in different ways, but here the main picture is the systemic findings related to tissue hypoxia. So when we talked about inhalation injury, we're really talking about different syndromes. The clinical manifestations, of course, are listed here, burns in the face, carbonaceous sputum, wheezes, ronchi, change in the voice, etc. Why is it important to diagnose inhalation injury? Because patients who come to the emergency room with burns and they also have inhalation injury, we have to anticipate a few things related to the management and related to the complications. First, they have greater fluid requirements. We may think that these patients need to be more dry to prevent pulmonary edema. It's rather the opposite. They need more fluids to maintain hemodynamic stability. These patients, we have to anticipate, they are going to have a greater risk of pneumonia. We have to be aware that the complication of this infection is the risk of this complication is greater. They have other pulmonary complications that we have to anticipate too. They may have atelectasis. Ventilation can be really very difficult sometimes. They may have hypoxemia because of VQ mismatch, etc. And also very important, they have an amplification of the inflammatory response. The inflammatory response due to the burn, whatever, 20%, 30%, is going to be amplified due to the inhalation injury. So these patients are the typical example that you may give to the students when you explain what SIRS is and how to distinguish SIRS versus sepsis or infection. This is a typical example of patients who have a high white cell count, they have a fever, very high fever sometimes, they have a hypotension, and it's all due to the inflammatory response due to the burn amplified by the inhalation injury, but they don't have infection at day two, day three after burn. There are different grading systems have been proposed, and unfortunately, none of them has been validated as to the relationship to mortality, and they are all based on the severity of the findings in bronchoscopy, from normality to slight signs of inflammation to severe signs of inflammation. And this is one proposed by Endorf in 2007. This is another grading system proposed more recently in 2018, but it's based on the same concept, bronchoscopic findings. So now we can say that the bronchoscopy is the gold standard to prove what inhalation is, which is inflammation in the lower airway. And we have to see that, we have to quantify that by bronchoscopy. And the way we diagnose inhalation has to do with the impact on mortality. And in this study, they showed that if we diagnose inhalation by bronchoscopy or by CO poisoning or by just the clinical findings or just by the history, this is the different in mortality as compared to the entire group of patients. These were 10,000 patients from the ABA, the American Burn Association repository database. And the largest impact on mortality is if we diagnose inhalation by CO poisoning. They have an excess mortality of 6%, or bronchoscopy, 3.6% excess mortality. What can we do to these patients? Recently, in a review paper in the New England Journal, it was proposed what we can do with these patients as to the diagnosis or the CO2 exposure, the CO exposure or whatever. In general, is supportive care. If there is carbon monoxide exposure, we have to administer 100% oxygen because the half-life of the CO bound to hemoglobin is much less if the FiO2 is 1 as compared to 0.21. Of course, if it is hyperbaric, it's even less. And other measures for treatment are just supportive. Of course, resuscitation is the first priority, resuscitation of the burn. I have to keep in mind that patients with inhalation have a greater requirement for fluids, not less, but more. We have to consider orotracheal intubation. Intubation, the indications for intubation are not really well established, but I would say in this meeting that if you are not an expert, you rather have a low threshold for intubation because you don't want to let the patient evolve to a situation in which you are not going to be able to intubate the patient. So have a low threshold for intubation. Of course, if there is altered mental status, you have to intubate. If there is upper airway obstruction, before this happens, you have to intubate. And of course, if it is hypoxemia or respiratory failure, you also have to intubate. If you are in a center, in a burn center where they have more experience, this criteria can be more restrictive, and you can wait to see if the patient really needs intubation. But if you are in another institution or you don't have much experience, you should have a lower threshold for intubations. And ventilatory management is again a general management. We want to avoid overdistension, as we do in general in acute lung injury. We want to, of course, give the lowest possible FiO2, and there are some ventilatory modes for which there is some evidence that they might be helpful in patients with inhalation injury, which is high-frequency percussive ventilation and upper and airway pressure release ventilation. These modes could be effective, particularly in this condition, in inhalation injury. But in general, ventilatory management is the same as in other types of acute lung injury. And finally, we proved, and this is an interesting issue, that really the other papers proving the same thing, that probably the increased fluid requirements in these patients are not due to inhalation, but probably just to mechanical ventilation. And related to this, we proved a few years ago that the worst prognosis that these patients have, if you, in the multivariate model, include the requirement for mechanical ventilation, is really due to the mechanical ventilation and not due and not to the inhalation injury. And this study, in which we compared, we did a multivariate analysis to see factors related to mortality in a derivation set and in a validation set, a large number of patients, only from our institution in Getafe. We showed that the p-value was significant for the relationship to with mortality, for age, the extension of the burn, both the burn itself and the full thickness burn, and mechanical ventilation, but not inhalation injury. So in the model, in this mathematical model, inhalation was not related to mortality, as opposed to what we all think, but ventilation, mechanical ventilation was the factor that was related to mortality. If you put this in the model, inhalation came out of the model and mechanical ventilation remained. So really the damage that we're doing to these patients with mechanical ventilation that they might require, of course, and this is why that's why we give this treatment, is the factor that is related to mortality rather than probably inhalation itself. So to finish up, just to remember the things that we can do to these patients, of course, oxygen, bronchial toilet, postural changes, physiotherapy, some treatments that are somewhat investigational, like N-acetylcysteine or inhaled heparin. And of course, we have to keep our first priority in the management in the management of these patients in their resuscitation. Fluid resuscitation is what is going to keep these patients alive until they overcome the resuscitation phase and they're able to go into the phase in which they are going to be operated on in different sessions. So thank you very much.
I think now we need to continue the program because it's very late. And next speaker will be Gaston Murias from Buenos Aires, Argentina. And Gaston, he will present the ventilator. I am sure that he will present data on the asynchronous. Gaston, it's your time. Please try to be on time for 15 minutes only.
I'm Gaston Murias from Argentina. I'd like to thank the organizer for the invitation to share this space. I have to talk about patient ventilator desynchrony, an issue that in the last decade has been increasingly in the focus for several reasons. First, it's highly prevalent, and the actual tendency to favor partial ventilatory support forecast it will be even more prevalent in the future. Second, we have demonstrated that occurs during the whole ventilatory period, all around the clock, and regardless of the ventilatory mode in use. Third, it's not just a cosmetic issue, because it has been associated with poor outcomes, like the increase in the time of mechanical ventilation and the need of tracheostomies. In our series, the biggest published up to date, it was also associated with both ICU and hospital mortality. In the next few slides, I will try to approach the synchrony from a mechanistic point of view in order to analyze the underlying mechanism that led to a poor patient-ventilator interaction. Ventilatory mechanics is usually approached using the Otis equation, which states that the airway pressure equals total PEEP plus volume times elastance plus flow times resistance. However, even when appropriated for total ventilatory support or spontaneous ventilation, is less suited for the case in which the two pumps, the ventilator and the patient's inspiratory muscles, are interacting. Instead, we propose an alternative model composed by two compartments. One of them represents the airways, the central compartment, and the other represents the alveoli, the peripheral compartment. As can be seen, all the volumes discriminated by the Otis equation are whole. And in this model, each change in airway pressure accounts for a change in the volume of gas inside the central compartment. So during inspiration, airway pressure is the product of the relationship between the flow added by the ventilator to the central compartment and the flow subtracted to the peripheral compartment, but the patient and the inspiratory muscles from the patient. This led to a very singular mechanism of desynchrony, that is flow desynchrony, that can be only be produced in volume control ventilation where the ventilator inspiratory flow is preset. As the area under the pressure time curve is a succedaneum of the mechanical power provided by the ventilator, as patient inspiratory effort increases, the amount of work delivered by the machine becomes progressively lower. Since born to death, we are either in inspiration or expiration. From turning on to off, the machine is also in inspiratory or expiratory program. We name it phase desynchrony, the mismatch between the inspiratory times of the patient and the machine. When the mismatch occurs at the beginning of the inspiratory time, we name it initial desynchrony. And when occurs at the end of inspiratory time, we name it terminal desynchrony. So four different cases account for phase desynchrony. Patient's inspiratory time can start or end before and after machine's inspiratory time. This will be the framework for my analysis, and we will start with terminal desynchrony. Patients do not have a pause. Instead, they breathe in a quasi-sinusoid way from inspiration to expiration. If their inspiratory time is shorter than machine's inspiratory time, at the beginning of their expiration, they found a still pressurized airway. So to exhalate, they have to increase the pressure in the peripheral compartment over the pressure in the central compartment. For that, they recruited their expiratory muscles. As the patient low on the central compartment, this led to a characteristic tele-inspiratory increase in airway pressure. On the other side, if the inspiratory effort go beyond the closing of the inspiratory valve, the pressure in the central compartment fall and can produce a new trigger of the machine. That is two inspirations without an expiration in between. This is probably the most dangerous mechanism of patient ventilator desynchrony, as far as actual tidal volume is well over the expected. In fact, it's doubled in volume control ventilation. This is a schema on the behavior of alveolar pressure. For simplicity, it has been represented during a spontaneous ventilation. As can be seen, the action of inspiratory muscles make alveolar pressure to fall below airway pressure. This is the inspiratory driving pressure that generates flow to the patient. When inspiratory muscles relax, the elastic recoil of the respiratory system increases alveolar pressure over airway pressure. This is the expiratory driving pressure that produces outflow of gases. Black arrow in the record of the left shows one breath in which, even when the effort is not enough to double trigger the ventilator, as occurred in the previous and in the following breath, still preclude the increase in alveolar pressure that produced the peak expiratory flow. The difference between those traces is just quantitative, and the presence of amputations of the peak expiratory flow should alert the physician on the risk of having double trigger short drift. Let's go now to initial desynchrony. To trigger the ventilator, the patient's inspiratory effort must produce a fall in the pressure of the central compartment. This cannot be accomplished directly. Instead, patient's effort increases the size of the peripheral compartment, producing a consequent fall in its pressure. This generates a pressure gradient between the central and the peripheral compartment and gas flow that reduces the volume and the pressure in the central compartment. However, if at the end of expiration the pressure in the peripheral compartment is still higher than in the central compartment, the first part of the inspiratory effort is used to overcome atropine. This is not only a waste of inspiratory effort, but also a phenomenon that delays the start of machine's breath. Moreover, if patient inspiratory effort is not enough to overcome atropine, an ineffective inspiratory effort happens. This cannot be seen in the pressure tank waveform, as no changes in airway pressure are produced, but can easily be seen in the flow traces because a fall in alveolar pressure reduce the pressure gradient for expiration and the expiratory flow in a characteristic way. Finally, even when well known since more than 30 years ago by physiologists, it is a phenomenon that has been just recently recognized in the clinical practice. Akumianaki et al. Alerted on the reverse triggering issue, where a passive insufflation of the respiratory system triggers patient's respiratory center. In other words, it's not the patient who triggers the ventilator, but the ventilator who triggers the patient. It's a very common event that has been ignored by physicians for long. Furthermore, as patient's breath starts after the beginning of the machine's breath, it usually also ends later. We recently found that one-third of the double triggering events were due to reverse triggering. In conclusion, patient ventilator desynchrony is a frequent problem that has been associated with poor outcomes. I strongly believe that to solve these issues at the bedside requires the understanding of the underlying mechanisms of the poor patient ventilator interaction. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Gaston, for your to be on time and for your excellent presentation. I think now it's time to move to the last talk by Pacheco Fortuna from Portugal, that he will introduce the information on new modes of mechanical ventilation.
Hi, hello. Good morning or good afternoon, depends where you are. Thank you very much for the opportunity and congratulations to the organization for this big event. I was asked to talk about new ventilator modes, and I'm just opening my presentation. Okay. And I have no conflict of interest, but as a bias, I'm an actual user of Hamilton C6 and Dräger V300, so that's the modes that I know best and I'm more used to deal with. What are the new modes? The future conclusions, that's my presentation. Modes of ventilation nowadays, as in the beginning of mechanical, invasive mechanical ventilation, all work the same way. We control the variable by pressure or volume. We control the breath sequence in a controlled intermittent or spontaneous way. And what's changing nowadays, it's the targeting scheme for the breaths. in the beginning, we had static set points where the user programmed the ventilator, and nowadays we are evolving to closed loop modes that are getting more and more intelligent and autonomous. In the whole modes, I have nothing to say. In the new modes, I put it under commas because the latest modes are in the late 2010. It's not so new. Everybody have heard about most of them, but the things are evolving, and I think it's good to talk something about them. In 2010, someone checked how many modes of mechanical ventilation are available nowadays, and they found 174 different names, but only 56 unique modes. So there are many and many new technology, but the principles are more or less the same. So closed loop, the programmer, the user, the doctor, the physician, the therapist programs the ventilator. The ventilator gives an output, then it gets some readings from the output they gave to the patient, and then the ventilator adjusts the output to meet the desired parameter that were programmed. Dräger has got available in the late 2007, I think, the smart care pressure support. Smart care is a winning mode. It's like the designation, a pressure support mode that helps winning automatically. The user programs, tells the patient body weight, if he had a COPD or neurological disorder, and then the ventilator monitors tidal volume, ETCO2, and spontaneous breathing every 2 to 5 minutes. Then it characterizes the patient in what kind of pattern of ventilation he have, and then it changes the pressure support to meet the program parameters, and always try to get normal ventilation but with the least pressure support, and then warns the user that the patient, when the patient is ready to win or to be disconnected. He even tries winning spontaneous breathing trials that can last at least 1 hour. Hamilton Medical is launched in the 1990s and a mode that is the ASV. ASV is a minute volume ventilation. It's based on pressure control, pressure or pressure support, and the user defines only the minute ventilation. In this example, 135% means that in an adult patient, the ventilator will target 135 milliliters per kilogram of ideal body weight per minute. And then the ventilator will try to get this minute volume ventilation, aiming for a normal and a safe tidal volumes and the safe frequency, monitoring time constant and work of breathing based on the two formulas well known. In ASV, oxygenation was managed by the user. Nowadays, Hamilton implemented the IntelliVent ASV that gathers the information on ETCO2 and SpO2, monitors time constant, respiratory rate, and tidal volume, and adjusts all the parameters. In this example, we have the ventilator monitoring ETCO2 and respiratory rates. The patient is active, so the programming will manage mostly based on the respiratory rates, and then we'll increase the support or decrease accordingly to the respiratory rates. If the respiratory rate is low, then it lowers the support. If the respiratory rate is high, he gets the support higher. In oxygenation, they use ARDS net tables to get the PEEP or FiO2, depending on the aimed SpO2, and then the user just have to tell the ventilator what are the safety limits of ventilation. Pro, what's good about this method? Automatic control. You get automatic control of oxygenation and ventilation. You get safety measures because it gets constant monitoring of time constant and worker breathing. They have controlled a safety measure to avoid auto PEEP, but it still depends on SpO2 and ETCO2 measurements. ETCO2 can have a great gap with PCO2, but in this case you can calibrate the measurements. But if you get a bad sign, you can't use this mode. It don't work well with periodic breathing or airway leakage because the ventilator will keep making adjustments, unnecessary adjustments. Medtronic has also, since the beginning of the 1990s, a PAV mode. It got updated in the mid 2007, I think. And it's a different pressure support mode that measures the inspiratory effort and tries to unload the patient. The user programs the percentage of supports based on the total muscle effort, and then the ventilator gets along with the muscle effort. So the curve will not be as pressure support high pressure curve, but the progressive increase of pressure, and the top pressure will be in the hand, like the respiratory effort of the patient. PAV plus gets an inspiratory pause every 5 to 8 breaths to calculate resistance and elastance and to get a greater accuracy on the measurement of the inspiratory effort. It gets greater synchrony. It's proportional to the patient effort, as it lowers the patient effort. There is one paper that tells that the patient have better sleep quality, and the patient get more time in spontaneous ventilation. It depends on the pneumatic triggers. It's only available for active patients. Compliance and resistance must be known, and there is a risk of runaway. If the compliance and resistance are overestimated, the inspiratory time can be greater than the patient needs. NAVA, it's an old, not so new mode, but it's also a closed loop. We measure the phrenic nerve electric activity, and we titrate the support we gave based on the electric activity directly measured. It's greater synchrony. You don't have over assistance, It's a great tool in non-invasive ventilation, and it can measure monitor weaning capability of the patient. It's just spontaneous and effective. So, evidence. In this setting, it's very difficult to make comparative studies because there are many different ICU settings with more or less physician staffing or more or less autonomy of the nursing staff. The great study about this kind of closed loop modalities was a Cochrane review in 2014 that tells us that basically the automated closed loop systems may result in reduced duration of weaning, ventilation, and ICU stay. But there is a great heterogeneity between trials, so more trials will be needed to achieve a greater significance. So the future, we set in the past we set the molds and we used to monitor the outcome. In the future, we set the outcome and monitor the mode. We will need more accurate feedback sensors. We should have more parameters measured and new evidence is being made on safety parameters. And we will get to more individualized ventilation based on this sensor and this feedback. So in conclusion, there is some evidence that closed loop modes reduce the duration of ventilation, the duration of unweaning, and the ICU length of stay. But the modes are getting more and more automated without compromising safety and increasing comfort to the patient. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your excellent presentation. I think now it's time for a discussion on by and Dr. Cordova.
Yeah, Dr. Artigas, good morning. Good morning, everyone. And we have only one question in terms of the time. We are some late. And the question is for Dr. Fortuna and the doctor from Buenos Aires. How the new modes can influence the outcomes and heart outcomes in terms of reduce the length of stay of mechanical ventilation patients and mortality, because we have outcomes in terms of synchrony, but how the new modes can influence or how can help in reduce the strong outcomes in patients in critical care?
The new modes don't do anything that the doctor want to do based on the actual evidence that is available. What could help is that because with less and less staffing of the ICUs and more work, it can help to get a more secure and more fast weaning of the patients. What the ventilator do in the automated modes is what we all of us do in every day of work. So in better synchrony, better weaning, and greater adjustments to keep in the safe zone, we'll have the patient less time in the ventilator. Proved by every aspect.
May I ask you, you and Gaston, need to avoid spontaneous ventilation in patients with DS? This is again a controversial point. No, I'm just asking to you and Philippe. If we the spontaneous with RDS is control. There is also not including outcome, although increase the probability decreased by increasing also the damage of the lung.
I think Antonio is a balance, you know. at the first part of the ventilatory support, where the lung is so inflamed and so on, maybe you can keep the lung at rest and use a ventilatory setup that has been demonstrated to reduce mortality. However, at the recovery part of the ventilatory support, where the objective is more to reduce the time of ventilatory support, maybe you can allow patients to be spontaneously with the new mode, probably, that favors synchrony. Yes. I think both responses are correct.
Yes, I agree with Gaston. Probably, if in the early phase, if you put a patient on pressor support, the patient will be in distress and the effort of breathing would be so much. In the late phase, I personally like to awake the patients as early as possible to have them cough, to have them recruit the lung, and when pressor support is, I think it's the greatest mode. Probably most of this data come from the driving pressure. Because when the patients start breathing by themselves, the driving pressure gets higher. But if the patient makes the effort for inspiratory effort, probably the phase, the increase of driving pressure is not so important. So I agree with Gaston.
Do you think for this is a very short question for all of you? Do you think that in the future it will be necessary to include a biological monitoring out there? Because you know, the problem is that we have only information on lung mechanics, but information physical effect of this mechanical ventilation.
Probably yes. The values like calorimetry and other biological markers can give us more information about the work of breathing, more accurate information about the work of breathing, and what we are doing to the lung. And I think it's one of the sensors I think will have to be developed.
Okay, I think Pablo, I don't know if we have more time for these questions, but probably it's time to close this session.
One question, please.
Thank you very much for all the...
Sorry, Dr. Artigas.
For the excellent presentations.
One question for Dr. Lorente. The question is simple. I always wait that inhalatory injury gets bad results. But it's not so. I want to know why. Why not inhalatory injury gets bad results?
Well, when we speak about inhalation injury, we really are speaking about different things that have different pathophysiology and different association with mortality. So if the injury is limited to the upper airway, which is of thermal origin, is only thermal injury to the upper airway, this really causes upper airway obstruction, and it doesn't really have an impact on mortality. But if the products of combustion of the air in the burn get to the lower airway and they induce an inflammatory response in the lower airway, this really has a stronger effect on mortality. And mortality of these patients is much higher as compared to patients with the same burn but without inhalation. And thirdly, you can have typical ARDS. So if the particles of the air get to the alveolar capillary membrane, they can induce there an increase in permeability and induced ARDS. And this is really the worst scenario in which the complication is really more severe. So if you have inhalation injury, we usually refer to tracheobronchitis, And in these cases, they may have gas exchange abnormalities. X-ray is normal. This is interesting. You don't expect these patients to have abnormalities in the X-ray, and unless they develop complications such as atelectasis. But they still may have hypoxemia. They may be difficult to ventilate. And these patients have a much greater mortality rate. This is just an inflammatory response to the compounds in the air that gets to the lower airway below the carina. But if the air doesn't get to the lower airway, the only thing that can happen is a thermal injury in the upper airway, and this is not associated with a significant inflammatory response with significant impact on mortality.
Jose Angel, do you have any specific recommendation to sedation? I agree fully with you that we need to keep the a negative balance sweep, but which kind of sweep? Do we need to use more albumin than crystalloids in these specific patients with an increase of extravascular water? Yes.
Yeah, thank you for the question, Professor Artigas. This question would really deserve an entire meeting only for this question. So the resuscitation is based on crystalloid resuscitation in these patients. Crystalloids that don't have high sodium content, such as normal saline, because they have also very high chloride, and these patients may get 20, 25 liters in one day or more. And this would be associated with acidosis, a severe hyperchloremia and acidosis. So we use Ringer's lactate. You may use only balanced fluids with also less chloride, but the basics is crystalloids. Albumin, now there's actually right now there's a study that is being planned by the European Society of Intensive Care, the burn, it's a group within the trauma section, which is a burn group, and we are planning a study on the use of albumin during the resuscitation phase. This is really controversial. Albumin will help, as there are studies already proving this, will help hemodynamic stability and would help reduce the crystalloid infusion. We have the hypothesis that early albumin administration could help reduce the crystalloids, could help therefore reduce the side effects of high volume infusion during the resuscitation phase, and it could be helpful. But this is really a hypothesis that should be tested. There are already papers showing that albumin helps resuscitation, helps hemodynamic stability, but we don't know the impact on other outcomes such as mortality.
And is there any specific local treatment? Because inhalation is a direct lung damage. I don't know if is evidence or recommendations for inhalation therapy for some specific treatment to try to recover the acute lung injury in these patients.
Yes, that's a very good question too. As you know, you yourself have studies on this. In acute lung injury and heparin. And heparin, there are some studies, there's pretty good evidence based on animal models on the beneficial effects of heparin, inhaled heparin, in inhalation injury. And there's some evidence also on clinical studies. So heparin would be really interesting as a therapeutic alternative. We don't use heparin, but we should probably consider that in our institution in the future. And other than that, you may also give antioxidants, but this is rather on the experimental side, and N-acetylcysteine, which is rather is innocuous, and you may expect some beneficial effects related to the antioxidant effects of N-acetylcysteine. But certainly heparin would be an alternative to consider.
Okay, so thank you very much, Pablo. I think it's time to close this session, because we are closing 15 minutes later, but also we start 15 minutes or 20 minutes later. So I think, again, thank you very much for all the speakers. and for the excellent presentations, and I'm sure that they will give you new information that could be useful to use or to take in account in your clinical practice in your ICU.
Thank you, Professor. Thank you, everybody. And see you in 5 minutes. Thanks.
Do more. Feel better. Live longer. At GSK, we have a very special purpose, but we live in a challenging and uncertain world where even more is expected of us.
We're on the brink of a seismic shift in the world's aged population.
Troubling news over rising costs and their impact on patients.
Our opportunity has never been greater. Science and technology is rapidly transforming our understanding of disease, and there is ever more demand for innovation. To become one of the world's most innovative, best performing, and trusted healthcare companies, we must respond. So let's take on this unique challenge together to change the world for the better. By having the courage to push the boundaries of research, harnessing our breakthrough science to bring needed quality healthcare products to more people, partnering with those who share our values to go even further, and most importantly, being in touch with society so people trust both our science and our intentions. Together, let's challenge ourselves today to change people's lives tomorrow.